Hey everyone, welcome to this week's Azure Infrastructure Update. It is Friday the 13th of January 2023, and a pretty quick update. As always, I have the chapters in the description, so you can jump to whichever one you care about the most. New videos, I got to part 5 of the Azure Masterclass Storage, so exploring all things really focused around the main storage account services, but a few other surrounding areas as well. I did a video on cron expressions. So if I think about scheduling some recurrence, cron expressions are a very popular format of expressing this, but not just in Linux, things like Azure Functions, when I want to schedule, I need to understand it. So I went through really what entails a cron expression. It's really not that hard when you actually understand what it's doing. And then outside of Azure and technology, a lot of people ask me for help on how to get started creating content. So I did a little virtual mentoring video about how I personally think about it, may not be right, about creating content. So maybe that helps. On to what's actually new. So on the compute side, Azure Red Hat OpenShift is now available in Brazil Southeast. So Red Hat OpenShift is a managed, built on Kubernetes, full PaaS service. So it's a container orchestrator, but it then brings a whole bunch of additional functionality around, hey, many services integrate with it just out of the box. There's hundreds of built-in integrations, has its own CI/CD pipelines. It has its own native stateless type services. It has multi-cluster management. So a whole bunch of things. I can now get that complete Red Hat OpenShift as a managed service in Azure that's actually managed, provided by both Microsoft and Red Hat. Moving on to storage. So UltraDisk is now available in some new regions. Remember, UltraDisk is that top tier, lowest latency managed disk solution. What sets it apart from most of the solutions is not just huge IOPS, huge throughput, and the lowest latency, but also the IOPS and the throughput are separate dials. I don't have to have it scale linearly with the capacity. I can say how much IOPS I want, how much throughput I want, and I can dynamically change those while the disk is in use. That is a characteristic now shared by the premium SSD V2 as well, but before the premium SSD V2, that was a very unique feature. So it's now available in Switzerland North and Korea South as well. Azure AD Authentication is available for managed disk import and export. So if I think about locking down access to my disks, one of the things I could do is, well, I can enable private link and I have to use a private endpoint to actually go and perform the interactions. But now what I can also do is require Azure AD Authentication authorization before I can do an import export of either the disk, or another way is to create a snapshot or the snapshot. What it's going to look for now is when I try to generate that shared access signature, which enables me to interact with the object, it's going to do a check on my account, and I have to have the data operator for managed disk role, or I could create a custom role, but it's going to have either the disks or snapshot download, upload actions. So this is now saying I can turn on within the disk. So if we actually quickly just jump over and we look at the portal. So if I'm here, if I was to just pick a disk, it doesn't really matter which one. But what you see is this disk export option. And we have here enable data access authentication mode. So if I check this box, I would then need that specific role before I'm allowed to actually go and perform that import export type thing. So that's now available in GA. On the miscellaneous, so Azure Backup has a number of updates for December 2022. This was really mostly around if I was doing backups of SQL running in a virtual machine. So what before it would do, when it wants to do an app consistent backup, it would do a type of full snapshot that would actually reset the log sequence numbers. And this might cause problems with other backup solutions I have. I could set a registry key, and that registry key would tell it, hey, do a copy only full, which wouldn't mess with the sequence numbers. What they've done is now with this update for December 2022, that registry key is just automatically set. So now it's always going to do that copy only full type snapshot and avoid any log number impact. Azure Site Recovery Monitoring. This is now going to surface in Backup Center. So Backup Center is that pane of glass that's really focused on the protected data. And I can have things from multiple subscriptions, different regions. Well, now my Azure Site Recovery assets are going to show in there as well. Integrates with things like policy and my monitoring, but just my Azure VMs, my VMware-based, my physical-based will show up in the Backup Center and give me that single pane of glass. AzAcSnap version 7 has gone GA. So this again comes to the idea that I've got a Linux VM. Now I say VM, this also could be a large instance running on bare metal, so those really large Oracle, for example. And so the point here is that I've got some Linux-based database, a third-party database, SAP HANA, Oracle, and I want to be able to get an database consistent backup. So what this utility does is it enables that clean backup of those third-party databases running in Linux. And now there's some preliminary support for Azure NetApp files. It's got some improved validation, some improved timeout characteristics, but it's just going to enable me to get those clean backups. And then finally, there's a VS Code extension for Azure Automation. So VS Code is fantastic. It's highly extensible that I can add in support for different types of technology. Well, now those runbooks I can create in an Azure Automation account. This could be PowerShell, could be Python. I can not only edit them within VS Code with this extension, but I can do the full management. Yes, I can do debugging, but I can actually try and trigger them. I can do management around them. There are a few caveats, and this is outlined in the documentation. So if we scroll down to the bottom, I mean, firstly, it tells us what we can do. So it gives us all the key features, and it talks about, well, PowerShell 5, 7, Python 2, Python 3, webhooks, automation, assets, debug, all these great features. It just has a few limitations. So for example, adding new certificates, creation of new schedules, just a few things to be aware of, but certainly most of the things you need to do, I can do within that extension. And that was it. As always, I hope this was useful, and I'll see you on the next video. Take care.